Okay.
Hi.
Hi, Terry Ackerman. This is
Yep,
Dave.
that's me.
We're bringing in folks just as fast as my hot little fingers can drag them along.
That I'm happy to see that. How many people are in the waiting room?
Well, we've got a bunch here. Okay, very,
Oh,
very
good.
nice. Let me start letting people in. Okay,
I'm
admit.
going to try. Right now, I'm on my phone. I'm going to see if I can switch over to my computer here.
Okay, standing by. Raymond. Okay, got a full house here. All right.
Great.
Adele, here we are. Raymond, here we are, coming along. Hey, Adele. Okay, Miriam. Hello, hello, hello.
Hi.
Are you in approve? Hang on just a moment. Yes, approve. Okay, we're just
Yeah,
being
hello.
doorman right now, letting everybody in. Okay, and Adele, I want to give you control. And
If you're recording, then that's fine, as long as one of us is. Oh, okay, so I'm recording too. Okay, whatever.
how can that be?
Welcome.
You both record at the same time?
Okay, so welcome to another Sunday Zoom.
Okay, welcome everybody.
We have two very special guests. Are they both here?
They seem to
Miriam?
be.
So,
Well, I'm here. I
of
don't
course.
know about my business.
Oh, okay. And Raymond is here. So we have two very special guests today. Not in the same place because of the situation in which we're living. Raymond and Miriam are a couple who made Aliyah with their family in 2018 from the Netherlands, just a month. What was it? Before the balloon arson started, they made Aliyah to Nachal Oz. They both—they'll correct me if I'm wrong here. They made Aliyah to Nachal Oz, and they're both volunteer firefighters. So that came in really handy when the fires started in our region. And they're living in Nachal Oz. They've been affected by the war that's going on now. Raymond wrote on our Facebook group about what it's like being in Nachal Oz, working with the cows. So I'm just going to let them both do their thing. And it's so good to see your smiling faces. Yeah.
It's good to see my wife on the
So when did you last see your wife? Yesterday?
Oh, yesterday. Not that long ago.
Okay, so to make this, just to clarify this, on his shirt it says Nachal Oz and there's a cow, how appropriate. Raymond is in Nachal Oz currently and Miriam is in Mishmaret.
Mishmaret. Yes.
Okay,
Yes.
so.
And that is the
Okay.
kibbutz in the center of the country, and Raymond is on their kibbutz down along the Gaza border. Just to understand, that's about an hour and a half to 2 hour drive, depending on traffic. So folks understand they're not next to each other.
Well, I wish it was an hour
I said,
and
depending
a half.
on
In a good
traffic
day,
on Highway
it's
6.
2 hours. In a good day, it's 2:15, and if I go back to Mirjam and Raymond, it's 3 hours, 3.5 hours, 4 hours, 4.5 hours. So that's something like that.
That's
Because
crazy.
the traffic is terrible.
Yeah.
We're all here digitally, at least. So let's go forward with where we are.
Okay. So yes, well, since the 7th of October, we were evacuated to Mishmaremek, like they said, it's more in the center of Israel. It's close to Haifa, like half an hour from Haifa. And we were here with the whole community, so that's why we basically stayed. But at one point, actually after a few days already, Raymond decided to go back to work in Nachal Oz because he is in charge of the farm and we have like a few hundred cows. So it's not that you can say, well, I'm not going there anymore. So he decided to go back. And ever since he's in Nachal Oz like 4 days, sometimes 5 days a week. And I am in Mishmar Emek alone with my children, we have three children. And that's how we are living now for 9 months. Not easy. Well, for me, it's not easy because I'm alone, but that's the only thing that I can complain about right now. For Raymond, it's a different story because he's so close to the border. So it's really hard to be there now, like during the days and the nights. But we think we didn't have so much of a choice. Now we decided to move to Netivot somewhere next month, whenever there are houses available in Netivot. And that means that we will be like 15 minutes from Nachal Oz. And then we can try to have a kind of normal life, that Raymond can go to work and that he come back home every day after work. We can be together as a family instead of living apart all this time, because it has been actually enough to live like this. But I'm not sure how it is in Nachal Oz, because I'm here, but that's better for Raymond to explain.
So just to clarify, before October 7th, why don't you tell people where you worked and what happened with that?
I was working in a visitor center, also on the border, Netiv Asra. It's a moshav on the border with Gaza. And I was basically hosting groups, especially from outside of Israel, like tourists. And I was explaining how it is to live on the border and how it is to raise children so close to the border with the constant terror of from the other side. Since the 8th of October, I have no work anymore. The place called Netiv LeShalom, it's the path to peace. And on the 7th already, she decided to quit. Of course, we were not allowed to go there for work, but I don't think she will restart again. So I'm currently without a job.
That's it? That whole thing is now closed?
Yeah, now it's closed for sure, but I'm not sure if she will be able to start over again, because she was already in a very, it was already very difficult for her to live in Netiv Asra after the war in 2014. She didn't really went back to normal life. It was very, very hard for her. So I don't think she will be capable to restart again, which is very sad, because it was a very, very nice project and whoever has been there once, maybe. Yeah, sad.
So, have any of you ever been to the wall in Netiv Asra? Any of you on the who are on the Zoom? It's this amazing project that she put together, the wall that was built there to protect them, to separate from Netiv Asra, which is right on the border, and the Gaza Strip. Was an ugly looking thing. So instead of having this ugly concrete wall, this woman made a business out of it. So she would bring people over and talk to them, tell them what it's like, what their lives are like there. And then there are these ceramics that she made, right? Shells, different colored ceramics. And people would, visitors would afterwards be able to take these ceramic pieces and place them on the wall, on the words that said Shalom, peace, in the Hebrew, Arabic, and English. That
I've was just sort posted of a, pictures in the chat.
Sort of a message to Gaza, to Gazans, telling them what the intentions here on our side were. And it was a beautiful project. That's so sad that it's not happening anymore. Raymond, what is it like milking cows on the border? What do the cows think of it? What are the situation? What are the conditions like?
How's the milk coming in?
Well, the cows don't give a damn about it, so that's a good thing.
Does the noise not affect them, like their milk
no.
production?
No, because we work with our own grown-ups, so all the cows we have here are calves we already had by ourselves, so they're not scared, they're used to the noise. So a war, even we lost 100 cows since 7 October by mortars, they don't react, they don't act, because they're used to it. The cow is a simple, it's a smart but simple animal. They grew up in voices like that, so they don't react. That's the thing. So it's not the cows we have to be worried about.
So what is it like for people to work there? What does your day look like? How is it different, aside from the fact that you're not with Miriam and your family and the rest of the kibbutz there? How is it different for you?
Different for me, I went back on the 10th of October, on the Wednesday, the 10th of October. So I went back here with soldiers. I couldn't move around without 9 or 10 soldiers accompanying me alone to visit the cow shed. And there was still fire everywhere. And when I was here, the bodies of the dead terrorists were still lying around. When I went to Saad and I had to go to Nachal Oz, the dead bodies were on the road. Even in the kibbutz, the dead bodies of terrorists were still on the road. And there was fire everywhere. It was the places in the kibbutz were still not cleared. Now it's more like large noises. Like, I think last week we had a few alarms. The rest of the time, it's a lot of loud noises. You can imagine if you try to sleep in Nachal Oz and they are blowing up a tunnel in Gaza that's like maybe 700 meters, 1 kilometer away, it's going to rock your house. So the whole day it's noises, helicopters flying around, it's attack helicopters shooting above your head, it's airplanes coming in low. We had because they went in the Shaiya and the armor was there, they had the, so the helicopters of the 669, the rescue division, come in really low, and then a fighter plane also comes really low, and they're finding those there's lights and everything. So it's not all the time alarms, but it's a noise, it's a constant noise. We have a constant noise of tanks driving around, tanks shooting, artillery shooting, planes flying over, helicopters flying over, attacking. It's a noise.
Hey, speaking of noise, Raymond, if we could ask you to look at your phone or your laptop, because your voice, when you turn aside, your voice fades out, and it comes in and out like that. There's a question about how are your children? How do they sleep? How do any of you sleep? Mirjam?
Yeah. My children are okay now. It's like 9 months, and I have no idea how children are doing it, but they are coping very well with all the things they went through. I think every parent of young children can say that most of the kids are, I don't know, they're so strong, and somehow they know how to survive and how to overcome this trauma. Because when I told my children that we were going to move to Netivot next month, it's actually our fifth the fifth time that we have to move in 9 months. So it's not not normal, of course. But when I told them, actually, the oldest, he is 14. He actually asked why we're not going to Nachal Oz, because he rather want to be home in Nachal Oz instead of moving again. So that's basically a good sign that he wants to be there. For me, on the other hand, I when we decided that we are moving back to the south, I think I cried for a whole day because I was too afraid to go there. And I'm still feeling stress if I think about going south. But I know that that my life is over there. And as long as I stay here in the north, the longer it will take for me to get back to some kind of normal. And the other two children are basically fine as well. They're okay. They're sleeping well now. In the beginning, not, of course. There were night that I think it took half a year for my daughter to sleep alone in her bed. But now she's better and we are sleeping. Raymond is not sleeping because he's waking up all the time from all the explosions and all the noises over there. But here in Mismaremek, we feel safe and we manage to get better slowly. Yeah.
Adele, did you want to ask a question?
Yeah, sure. So have your children been back to Nachal Oz yet? And are there other families from Nachal Oz that are going to be in the Tibot, or is it just you as a family that decided to move to the Tibot?
Well, Raymond can answer about Nathan. He took the oldest one to Nachal Oz one day, so you can tell us that.
I wasn't there, so.
Okay. My oldest son really wanted to go back to Nachal Oz. He's 14, and he's a guy that wants to join the army. And I don't know. We have to be concerned about our army in 3 years when all these kids turn 18. If they really want to defend our country or just want to kill everybody. I know kids that say, and they are like kids are 14, 15 years old. They say, I still have an open check with them. So let's see how that picks up. But he's a strong guy and he wants to go back home. And went with me like, that's more than a month ago, it's like 2 months ago. And he felt fine. The other two kids didn't come here because there's a lot of noise still and they're smaller. So why bother to drive 2 hours here for them to maybe get stressed or something? Yeah, we can do that when we are in the depot. For the question about the families moving back to like Netivot, it's 50 heads, so it's not, I think it's like 1/3 of the kibbutz is going back to what, and 1/3 is staying behind in Mishmar Emek, and 1/3 is private. There's a lot of problems in all the kibbutz, I think, and it's all the kibbutz in Odovaz. There's a lot of people that have problems with going back or not, making decisions or not. A lot of people don't make decisions anyway, so they just hang around. And
we can't hear you. We can't hear you, Raymond.
Well, I'm talking as loud as I can, so nothing okay. I can do. So Mirjam can take over.
Like Raymond said, there's like 1/3 of the kibbutz will move back to Netivot. Most of them are families with children, actually. There's 1/3 who's staying in Mishmar Emek, and then there's about 1/3, like 30%, who is on their own, like somewhere in Israel. From of the age of 18, you are allowed to go back to Nachal Oz. So every family with children younger than 18 are not allowed. But there are still, there are now two families who decided to go back, and the army said it's actually kind of their own risk to take your children back to Nachal Oz now in these times, because there's still a war. But those families decided to not to wait any longer. So I think next week the first family will go back. And then, but there's nothing, you know, there are no people, there's no pool, there's no grocery store, everything is closed. So I don't really understand what people are doing with their children now in what they're going to do over there, because there's nothing, there are no friends, there's no school, there's actually nothing. But yeah, they really want to go back and nobody can stop them. And I need to say that these families are also getting a house in Netivot, that whenever it's going to be too hard, that they have a place to go. When it's too hard in Nachal Oz, when the noises are too bad, that they can go to Netivot. But yeah, so there are people going, but it's not really allowed, let's say that way.
There's no schooling either for the children?
Was
it set up for Netivot?
Yeah, they have holiday now anyway, but the children are going back to Sharon Negev. So that's their school where they were learning already. That's another thing what I'm not sure about yet, because Sharon Negev school, like, it's like not even like 3.5, maybe 4 kilometers from the border. So I'm really afraid that if I will send my daughter back to Sharon Negev, to the school, that she will get a lot of the noises, that it will affect her. But on the other hand, she wants to go back because all her friends are going, most of the friends are going back. And it's very important that after all these months, when they go back to school, it's 10 months. So she hasn't seen a lot of her friends for more than 10 months. So for the children, it would be good to be together. But I'm not sure if Sharon Negev is the best choice to go. And so we didn't decide yet about school. But yeah, there will be school in September.
That's not those who don't know, Sharon Negev is by Sderot, and it's about a 15-minute drive up the highway, up the main highway that goes along the border with Gaza. But it's in the Sderot vicinity, and it's the regional council center. So we would hope that security would be greater there, and you would get some safety in numbers from Sderot. You're conflicted about that, though.
So yeah, well, in Sharon Negev, in Eshkol, in my region,
to the
I
south.
Know that they're having meetings, even like tonight, there's a meeting about education. The high school kids are going back to Nofei Bzor, to our high school. And there's no alternative. If parents don't want to send their kids there, they can send them any place else in the country where they're living. But there's no other option. But I know that for the grade schools, they're working on an alternative school that's not quite so close to the border. Are they talking about that for Sharon Negev as well?
Yeah, well, actually, that's what they promised. And Sharon Negev, the school, wants everybody back. So they make it really hard to make a different choice. There will be in Ruhama, so that's more further away from the border. And there's nothing, like this whole war, there hasn't been one alarm, one rocket alert or whatever in Ruhama. So that is an option. But they said it's only for children for Nachal Oz and Kfar Aza. And the Kfar Aza and Nachal Oz are the kids from Kfar Aza and Nachal Oz are the most traumatized children we have in Sharon Negev. So in my opinion, it's not the best, also a difficult choice to put them together in one classroom, only these kids. Besides that, the Kfar Aza is only coming back, maybe the ones who want to come back are only coming back in December. So it means that my daughter needs to be from September until December with only the children of Nachal Oz. So it means that she will be in a classroom with maybe 3 children. But so it's also not an option.
In Ruhama, they're building houses for Kfar Aza. An extension of Kfar Aza in Ruhama, so their families will be living there.
Yeah, but they were only coming back in somewhere in December when it's finished, when they finished building. So until December, she would be kind of alone in school. And, you know, and it's also, there's no transportation. If they go back to Sharon Negev, they will be coming a bus to Netivot, pick up the children, bring them to school, bring them back. But then if we decide to let her study, go to Rochama, we have to bring her out by ourselves every morning to school. And it's like 25 minutes, I think, from Netivot. It's not that, like 20, 25 minutes. So they make it, they're making it very, very hard to even be able to decide something else as Sharon Negev. It's, I think it's very, very sad that they somehow they try to kind of almost force you to go back. You have, they give you another choice, but actually you don't have a choice because it's, it would be too difficult to do it yourself.
So it's the same thing by us, although it's gotten better because at first they were saying that any kids that are not going to our regional schools, the parents don't get money for them. So there was like really forcing them, and now they've gone back from that. And so we'll see. You're right. It's a very complicated situation. And I'm so glad I am not the parent of a school child in these situations. And also we don't know who's going to be teaching there. Like not all the teachers in the schools also live in those areas. So I know that there are a lot of challenges with getting enough teachers for the different subjects, for the different grades and ages. And parents here are just freaking out trying to understand where to sign their kids up because you're supposed to be signing your kids up already for school. Yeah. And who's going to be like in September?
Yes, it's difficult.
I think the biggest problem around here is that the army still don't take the kibbutzim seriously.
In what sense? In what sense?
In Nachal Oz, we have a base next to Nachal Oz. That's the base where all the girls were abducted or murdered. And now they decided to move the base further away, back, not forward, back. So when something is going on, they could react easier. So that means you're pushing the kibbutzim forward instead of backwards. There was an army guy that came to us and said, no, well, we're going to make you a real good Wi-Fi because if it happens again, at least everybody has Wi-Fi. And then as people living here, you think, wait, you just told me if it happens again, that's what you said. So we already lost the trust in the army from the 7th of October, and there's not really something they're doing now to get the trust back because they're moving backwards. They still, it's, I don't know, it's, it feels like a joke.
In other words, the kibbutz protecting the army.
Two questions that were asked. If you are having kibbutz meetings like Adele has with Nirim in Be'er Sheva, for your asefot, your kibbutz member meetings, which is a standard thing that happens on kibbutz. And the other question is, Raymond, what are you doing with all the milk from the cows? Is Tanuva taking the milk? Is the local cooperative taking the milk from the cows?
No, our milk stable is fine. We lost a lot of milk in the beginning. After 7 October, we lost 100 cows from this because we couldn't. They burned our milk stable, so we couldn't milk for 10 days. After that, it was fixed. So we started milking again. We had a few mortar attacks falling into the groups. Killed a few cows. No, not a few. A lot of cows. So since 7 October, we lost like 100 cows. But we're now 9 months further. And because before the 7th of October, we planned a lot of birds, technically we're now on our schedule like before the 7th of October. So the milk shed is doing fine.
There's another question here. Are there also enough psychological services for all the ages of the children's, the different children's groups?
Good question. We don't know.
I think the bigger problem is that Sharon Negev was always with a lot of people that worked in, like Hossein, they worked in psychology and everything. But the biggest problem is nobody understands the impact that it has on all the people. So I already, always know that the psychologists and the social workers can't cope with a thing that happened here because they're not trained for it. So it's going to take a long time before somebody is going to say, oh, we learned now and this is the way to cope with it, because really they could cope with the rocket, they could cope with anxiety about rockets, but nobody expected this. And I don't think anybody is prepared or learned to cope with this kind of situation.
Any other questions from the audience? Or Mirjam, you were going to speak?
If you want to.
Let me ask you honestly, long term, do you see yourself going back to kibbutz or going to a netivot and settling there?
In the future, you mean?
Longer term, not the next 6 months.
Well, longer term. Now we have like the government decided that if we're going to Netivot, we can stay there for a year. So we have time until summer 2025. So we have a year time to think about what we want to do in the future. We know that in 1 year, a lot of things can change. We don't know how this war will end, when it will end, what will be over from, for example, Hamas and all the terrorist organizations, and how the future will be. But in my heart, I want to go back because it's my house. It's the only place I know in Israel to call home. We have a house. We bought it around like 2 months before the war started. So it's not only a wish to go back because it's home, but it's also very difficult to not going home because we have our obligation. We have a mortgage. We have a loan. We have to pay for this house. So it's not so easy just to say I'm not going back anymore. There are a lot of things you have to calculate and you have to think about before you can even decide. But first we need to see when and how the war will end. And then we maybe will be able to decide. I have no idea. I don't know how you can make a decision anyway. You know, it's really, like Raymond said, it's really hard to trust anybody again, to trust the army, to trust the government again, because they really left us alone, for sure. So it's very hard to trust them again. And also what Raymond said, that they're moving the army base, which is next to our kibbutz, they're going to move it more further away from the border. So it means that actually Nachal Oz will be kind of in between the border. Then you will have Nachal Oz and then you have a military base. That's not so much of that I think was nice for the future. And I really don't know what to think about it. So,
brief question. How can people from the US or abroad in general help more directly to your predicament of people of your kibbutz and your community? What would bring you some relief from abroad?
I always said it for sure. It's very important that people are talking about our situation, because if you need to rely on the media, especially in other countries, you don't know anything. Like, people have no idea what's happening. People have no idea of our situation. So for sure, it's important to talk about that, to spread the truth and to tell what's happening, what's happened to us, what's happening to the other communities. I think that's one of the biggest, most important things, because like as we see that the anti-Semitism is growing and growing, and it's because people just don't know what's happening. So that's the most important thing. And besides that, of course, we have a lot of programs for donations, and we are thinking about the future, and we're thinking about what to do with all the donations. We're writing plans, and we're making we're thinking about the future, because you know we want to go back, but like I said, we don't know if it will ever happen, but it's very the wish of a lot of people to go back to the end.
So does your kibbutz have a website for making?
Yes, but I actually don't know it from my
okay, but I can send it anyway. We can post it on the site. What I can tell people is I'm sure the story with Nachal Oz is the same as with Nirim. We are currently raising money, not only to rebuild and develop things for the future so that we have an infrastructure that we could come back to, but even programs just for now, programs to help people deal with the trauma. This takes money. And so the needs are ongoing, and the needs are for the near future, and the needs are for the distant future. So if you want to get that website, and when we post the recording of this Zoom, we can put it up there on Life on the Border, and maybe people will want to help contribute to the Nachal Oz Fund and help you guys rebuild and go home.
We have about 3 minutes coming up. I gather you have family, both of you watching this now, some people from, I believe, family. If they want to say anything, words of support across the internet through Zoom to support you, if I understand correctly. It doesn't have to be in English, it can be in Dutch.
Well, if my family would show up, that would be really surprising, but.
Okay. I gather it's friends or family that are some of the people here. I wasn't sure, but I'm sure everyone watching.
Will see it later.
Sorry?
I said my family will probably see it later, and then they will say, I saw you on the internet.
For me, what the international community can do is, it's not for me, because I'm here already 9 months. I'm already working 9 months in a war zone. I'm not looking for money. I'm not looking for anything. I'm just looking for some, how you call it, some attention, some
moral
acknowledgement,
support. And
moral support. And I wish that everybody from outside will go to Israel. You don't have to go to Nachal Oz, really. It's not, because it's not a happy place right now. But go to Jerusalem, spend your money in Tel Aviv, whatever you want, but support Israel. And I think that's the biggest thing we need now. We will hold the border right now, and I don't need money for that. But the biggest thing, even with the political thing going on, I don't care about politics. Come here and support our nation. That's it.
Well, as one person said here, thank you for your time and sharing, Valerie. I'll share your story and pray. Thank you for sharing your stories. Stay safe. And I'm sure we all can agree on that. And we've got a minute left. Adele, do you want to close?
Yeah, so I want to thank everybody for joining us here today. I want to thank Raymond and Mirjam for coming together from their different spots. I've met Mirjam before. I look forward to meeting you, Raymond. And next time I'm driving by Nachal Oz, I will give you a call and see if you're available to get my own personal hug. And the support of the people here is very important for all of us. As Raymond said, your support, it matters. It truly does.
So, thank you everybody for being with us, and stay tuned for next week's Zoom. We will have on the founder of the Children's Museum of the Galilee. And that's going to be a very special show, and we'll be billboarding it. So stay tuned and follow us. Yeah, Art, there you go. All right. Thanks, y'all, for being with us on Life on the Border, everybody. And share this program around. It's very, very important. Thanks once again.
Thank you.